In the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. For the glory of God, let us join in singing, Freedom is here. Freedom is here.
So let your power flow. I'm not shaking, I'm not letting go. And everything comes alive in my life as we lift you higher. Let your freedom arise in our lives as we lift you up. Sing it out, sing it out. Let your freedom arise in our lives as we lift you up. Sing it out, sing it out. Freedom is here.
Let us worship the Lord. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship him in spirit and truth. The glory of God, let us raise and sing him for the beauty of the earth. For the beauty of the for the glory of the skies, for the love which from above o'er and round around us lies. Christ our Lord, to you we raise this our hymn of grateful praise. For the wonder of each hour, of the day and of the night, hail and rain and tree and flower, sun and moon and stars of light, Christ him of grateful praise for the joy of human love, brother, sister, parent, child, friends on earth and friends above, for all gentle thoughts and mild. Christ our Lord, to you we praise this our hymn of grateful praise. For yourself as gifts divine to the world so freely given, agent of God's grand design, peace on earth and joy in heaven. Christ our Lord, to you we raise this our hymn of grateful praise.
We'll follow second order of worship, adoration of the Trinity, adoration of the Trinity. Holy, holy, holy Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Glory be to you, O Lord Most High. Blessed he who has come and is come in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, O God. Holy are you, O God. Holy are you, O Almighty. Holy are you, O Almighty. Holy are you, O Immortal. Holy are you, O Immortal. O Lord, our Redeemer, who was crucified for us, have mercy upon us. O Lord, our Redeemer, who was crucified for us, have mercy upon us. O Lord, Holy Spirit, have mercy upon us. O Lord, Holy Spirit, have mercy upon us. O Lord, accept our prayers and praises and have mercy upon us. O Lord, have compassion and mercy upon us. Confession. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he who is faithful and just will forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but we have one who is in every respect has been tested as we are, yet without sin. Let us kneel and examine ourselves in silence, remembering our past. Let us humbly confess our sins to the Lord Almighty God. Let us say the prayer together. Almighty and most merciful God, we have erred and strayed from your ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have offended against your holy laws. We have left undone those things which we should have done. And we have done those things which we shouldn't have done. And there is no health in us. But you, O Lord, have mercy upon us, miserable offenders. Spare them, O Lord, who confess their faults. Restore them that are penitent according to your promises declared in humankind in Jesus Christ our Lord. And grant, O most merciful God, for his sake, that we may hereafter live a godly, righteous and just life to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
My faith looks up to thee, the Lamb of Calvary, Savior divine. Now hear me while I pray. Take all my guilt away. Oh, let me from this day
May the Almighty and Merciful Lord grant us pardon and remission for our sins, time for amendment of life, and the grace and the comfort of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us say the prayer of collect together. Creator God, Redeemer of the whole creation, we thank you for your redeeming grace that has liberated us and set us free. Grant us your grace to be strengthened by your redeeming power so that we become the stewards of your creation. In Jesus' name, that grounds for liberation. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forevermore. Amen. Now we listen to the readings. The first lesson is taken from Book of Prophet Ezekiel, chapter 36, verses from 24 to 36.
Because of famine. Then you will remember your evil ways and wicked deeds, and you will loathe yourself for your sins and detestable practices. I want you to know that I am not doing this for your sake, declares the sovereign Lord. Be ashamed and disgraced for your conduct, O house of Israel. This is what the sovereign Lord says. On the day I will cleanse you from all your sins, I will resettle your town, and the ruins will be rebuilt and desolate. Land will be cultivated instead of lying desolate in the sight of all who pass through it. They will say, this land that was raised was become like the Garden of Eden. The cities that were lying in ruins, desolate and destroyed, are now fortified by any hand. Then the nations around you that remain will know that I, the Lord, have rebuilt what was destroyed and have replanted what was desolate. I, the Lord, have spoken, and I will do it. Here ends the reading.
Praise be to thee, O Christ. The second lesson is taken from Paul's letter to Romans, chapter 8, verses from 18 to 25. Romans, chapter 8, verses from 18 to 25. I consider that what we suffer at this present time cannot be compared to all with the glory that is going to be revealed in us. All of creation waits with eager longing for God to reveal His sons. For creation was condemned to lose its purpose, not of its own will, but because God willed it to be so. Yet there was the hope that creation itself would one day be set free from its slavery to decay and would share the glorious freedom of the children of God. For we know that up to the present time, all of creation groans with pain, like the pain of childbirth. But it is not just creation alone which groans. We who have the Spirit as the first of God's gift also groan within ourselves as we wait for God to make us His sons and set our whole being free. For it was by hope that we were saved. But we see what we hope for. Then it is not really hope. For who hopes for something he sees? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. Here ends the reading. Praise be to thee, O Christ. For the glory of God, let us sing Him all things bright and beautiful. Gospel reading, Gospel according to St. John, chapter 20, verses from 19 to 23.
The third reading is taken from the Gospel of St. John, chapter 20, verses beginning to read at 19 to 23. Jesus appears to his disciples on the evening of that first day of the week. When the disciples were together with the doors locked for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and side. Disciples were overjoyed when they saw the Lord. Again Jesus said, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, I am sending you." And with that, he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive anyone his sins, they are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven." Here ends the reading. Praise be to thee, O Christ.
Praise be to thee, O Christ. Let us sing, "Master, speak, thy servant heareth." Speak thy servant heareth, waiting for thy gracious word, longing for thy voice that cheereth. Master, let it now be heard. Let us pray. Let the words of my mouth, meditations of our hearts, be acceptable in thy sight, O Rock and our Redeemer. Amen. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, I greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Today we are supposed to open our churches for corporate worship. In other words, a kind of fellowship which was again restricted by many problems and many do's and don'ts. But I think God is great to us in giving such kind of conditions so that we will realize again what is going to be our destiny in the future. Are we going to take life seriously or living seriously? This is the problem we are going to meditate in the future days. But whatever it is, we decided in our pastorate committee not to open our churches for unnecessary risk, risking our life and risking the life of others and the community. Therefore, the closing continues for some more time. And from time to time, the committee, the elders will decide when to open and how to go about it. Restrictions are very severe, and there's a lot of restrictions for old people and the children, and also singing part and taking part in the communion. And therefore, it is not worth to have fellowship in the time where there is increase of infection in Bangalore and deaths are also increased. Therefore, it is a wise decision from our side to stop for a while the worship in an open space like the church. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, this is exactly the problem we are going to discuss in today's theme. The creation is groaning. Creation is groaning. Creation is God's act. Any creation. And creation also means people who create in this world their own records, their own history, their own material world.
And thereby, a creator is more important than the created beings. Therefore, today we are going to discuss or meditate upon the theme, creation is growing. What is creation and what is groaning? Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters in Christ, a brief time I would like to draw your attention to the whole concept of creation related to the Trinitarian God, Jesus, the Father, and the Holy Spirit. And creation for us is not a new subject, it's an old subject. But understanding of creation changes from time to time. And today, we are in a position to understand creation better in our crisis. A crisis which has given rise to so many problems. The real meaning of groaning comes in this context. Groaning is something very painful. Groaning is something which is very cruel in understanding the experience of a person or the creation or the animal world which groans. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters in Christ, let us attend to see what creation is. Creation is work of God and which He produces, and He produced the world, and that is in it, everything God produced, and partly without the use of the pre-existing materials. Genesis first talks about, the one first chapter talks about, there's already something where Holy Spirit was brooding around that. Therefore, there is already something existence, pre-existing material. And partly out of these materials, that is by its use, fit or unfit, I think God manifested His glory by creating a new creation out of chaos. That was the Genesis first chapter we find. Therefore, there was already material existed, and their materials were also in chaotic condition. And God separates everything in the time gap of 6 days, Bible says, maybe 6 million years, we don't know. But the material was reused in creation of this world and this, the land, human beings and everything. Therefore, it is work of God. It produces all that is in it. And what is fit for glory of God is taken and manifested through His creation, and it is the work of the Trinity. They say we create human beings in our image. Spirit was already brooding over the waters. There was darkness, there was no light. There was water, and God separated light and darkness. And God separated land and water. God created separate species to fill the earth, and also He created a special species called human being who is in the image of God. This is God's wonderful act of creation. Therefore, we must praise God for this wonderful information on creation in the book of Genesis. The time, dear brothers and sisters in Christ, time is not spiral. Time is linear. It moves from one place to another. Therefore, the word beginning, in the beginning, is used in the Bible. If you read the first chapter, in the beginning, He says, God was there. In the beginning means, it is not just starting point of God's creation. In the beginning means, that beginning is also an eternal. If you look at this word very carefully, in the beginning it says, beginning can be from now also. Now towards end, we don't know which end and which beginning we don't know. Therefore, time is eternal according to the word beginning. Therefore, in the beginning God existed. Therefore, time need to be understood from the perspective of the creation. Creation may be the starting point of our existence, our life.
human source. God is the human source. And creation out of nothing. He created out of nothing. As I earlier told, that there was some material existed. The darkness was there. The waters were there. The land and everything was mixed up. And there was a chaotic condition. God separated these things. Maybe he used it and reorganized this material which was already existing. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, today scientists are exploring these possibilities in other planets. We don't know how many planets are there in this universe, in this cosmos. Therefore, God is a God who is God who created the universe. The material is abundant, resources are abundant, and this was used by God to organize human life to the future. At least we know this earth. Earth has some good life bodies, and this life is for his glory and also for our existence, for our living. And we need to fulfill the purpose and goal of God who created us and this great creation. Therefore, creation is God's. Creation out of nothing. It comes from nothing. The final purpose of creation is for the happiness and salvation of human beings. That's what the whole Bible talks about. And it's also recreation and renewal of the creation for his glory. Always God renews creation and human beings also for his glory. The decay and destruction he will not allow forever. Even in the nature, even in the environment. It takes a new birth, it takes a new formation. A new energy will come up. Therefore, creation is a very serious issue we need to understand in our context today. And God also made human beings in his own image. This is something great. And therefore, anthropologists and sociologists are trying to see what is the origin of human species. Therefore, evolution theory comes in. And this evolution theory talks about man from ape, ape from man now. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, and doctrine of creation is also talks about the original matter according to Genesis. And it is also God created this world according to his plan, not human beings' plan. And we try to put our own plans in our created beings. Therefore, sometimes we get into a lot of problems. And God is a creator who determines and he destines people's life according to his own plans, and our responsibility is to understand God's plan. The second part of the creation is not just a material, a life system, but it is also a spiritual world. God also created material world, and he also created a spiritual world. So we cannot avoid the spiritual beings said in the Bible and their responsibilities and our role as spiritual beings. Normally Christians, we think only material world from the Genesis, from the creation point. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, I think our attitude should change in understanding the spiritual beings of creation created by God in the creation story. Therefore, God created this great spiritual world. What is this spiritual world he created? The first one is God created not only material, it is also his spirits and the angel, the world of angels he created. Existence of angels. Many liberal Christians, we don't take very seriously. But I think there is some deeper meaning in the whole thing, and we need to reread the Bible from Genesis to Revelation so that we will understand the role of spiritual beings created by God
during his creation time. Therefore, creation is not just a stage of beginning, but it is eternal. Behind your life, behind the pre-existence, it goes thousands or maybe millions of years. Therefore, existence of angel in the Bible is a reality. People have encountered it. And today we need to understand the role of these spiritual beings, not just the beings created by God and their positions and our responsibility. It is also to know how God acted through angels, the spiritual beings. Let me draw your attention to some of the spiritual beings which are created by God. First of all, you have names like cherubim. This is an angel, a very powerful angel, always guarding the holy tabernacle of God. That's why you have from the beginning that cherubim and seraphims are the major and the main powerful angels appeared in the biblical narrations. And therefore, cherubim is the one which guards the holy temple, holy place of God Almighty. The second one, seraphim, is also mentioned in Isaiah chapter 6 and other parts. And it is guarding and also praising God forever and ever. The duty of the seraphim is to praise God and His glory forever and ever. Therefore, it is time immortal. And God is the God who lives eternally. Therefore, this also represents God's power, eternal power through its activity. And you have the powerful angels like Gabriel, which communicates to the world and also to the people. And also Michael is an angel of the warfare. In its spiritual warfare, I think we have to remember angel Michael. And this is not mythology, but Bible talks about all these stories. And also, work of the angels. What are the works of the angel? Now, in the God's creation, the material world, the life, and we have responsibility of human beings, and we have to take care of this creation. Similar way, this spiritual world, in the spiritual world, angels are also given some job, responsibility to complete. What are those things? First thing is praising God, and that was said in the first cherubims. And secondly, serve the inherited people who have their salvation from God. They have to serve the people. Look at the wonderful way God puts these things to the angels. Angels are there to serve human beings. And this is also part of creation. And angels are also rejoicing at the conversion of the sinner. Luke chapter 15. He talks about the conversion of a sinner, prodigal person. And thereby angels rejoice. And watch out the believers. How many of us believe that angels are there to watch our life every day, every moment? That's why sometimes we are saved. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, God gave the Spirit a comforter. Along with that, we have angels also. Look at the wonderful way God leads us, protects us. And what a privilege we have. And watch out, watch our believers, watch out our activities. Protect the little ones. Children also are protected. Matthew chapter 18, Jesus says, all this comes from Jesus, 18:10. He says, you protect the children. Your children are not just free like any other animal or anything like that. They are protected by God. God takes care of your children, their education, their going and coming, their walking. Everything God takes and takes care of your children. And angels are there to convey the believers to Abraham. It connects people to Abraham. According to chapter 16 of Luke, verse 22, Jesus speaks. Jesus is talking all this. Therefore, it is to connect us to the faith community and also to God. And therefore, it also bears a kind of, you know, it brings special revelation from God. And Daniel chapter 9, you come across this wonderful act of communicating or revealing God's plan to Daniel. And therefore, it is the duty of the angels to communicate all these things and communicate believers to his people. From people to people it communicates, and also execute judgment. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, many a times we never realize this relationship with human beings and the angel, the spiritual world God created. Therefore, creation is not just human and also material world, the life forms, but also spiritual beings. And this is the end result of human salvation. And we are part of this God's creation, which is spiritual and material, and man is there to take part in both the activities. He is there in the part of the created world, and is also part of this human spiritual world God created. Therefore, our responsibility is to relate to this. Therefore, we are not just worldly people, we are here immanent, but also we are transcending in our nature. Therefore, there is a question that, you know, fallen angels, they come before God created human beings. That's what the book of Genesis talks about, that when human beings were, Adam and Eve were kept in the Garden of Eden, the Satan enters, and then he separates people, I mean God's creation, the human beings, from God. And the first sin he brings is a lie. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters in Christ, the disobedience is part of telling lie. And that's what the fall takes very seriously in nature. And the second biggest sin was committed by Cain, the son of Adam. And therefore, these fallen angels has their own history. And God created these heavenly beings beautifully and also very in his own glory. But the fallen angel, led by Lucifer, he takes one part of the fallen angels and he comes and wants to destroy the created world. And this is where, from the curse of Adam, the wages of sin is death. The curse comes very clearly to Adam, and therefore the same curse continues with the human beings. And God again wants to recreate the whole world, recreate and renew the whole world for his glory and for his own purpose. Therefore, this is the salvation history we have. So if you take Genesis from 1 to 10 chapter, it talks about all these stories, all these doctrines. What is fall, what is creation, what is human beings, and how God restores, and how God brings salvation to the humankind, the flood, everything. The story comes very clearly in that. And after that, you have history of nations. Abraham, the faithful, the spiritual world begins in the creation story from the book of Genesis, from chapter 11 onwards. Therefore, the history of the spiritual world, the history of people following God, starts from the book of Genesis chapter 11, from the history of the patriarchs. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters in Christ, now what is groaning? The first chapter, Ezekiel, talks about this glorious vision, glorious separation of God, and God separates evil and good. And therefore, the whole book of Ezekiel speaks about the spiritual world of God, who created the spiritual beings. And there are different kinds of, you know, forms of spiritual world God created. If you read first chapter, there was a kind of a thing which moves like our modern equipment, but it is created by God. And therefore, Ezekiel speaks about both this world very clearly. and also Isaiah, and also Daniel. So we have these kind of visions in the Bible. Vision for the world and vision for the spiritual world. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters in Christ, we need to understand what is groaning. What is groaning? The groaning begins from the sin committed by Adam and Eve. There, the creation is affected by human sin. Look at the irony of it. The creation is nothing to do with the sin, whereas human beings, they inflicted or they infected the creation, the God-created beings from their sin. So Satan also started operating because on creation, because God created the creation. Because of God's creation, maybe Satan enters this created world and he destroys it. Bible says he came to destroy, to kill. And killing is a major destruction is major duty of Satan against God. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, the groaning begins. Groaning is understanding the death and decay by creation and also by human beings, which is an act of Satan, act of evil. Evil forces only destroy, evil forces only decay. They will destroy the world, they will bring death. This is the vision of John in Revelation also. End times, it is very clear. We cannot avoid these things. We being spiritual beings and also created from the earth, we cannot deny the spiritual world and accept only material world and asking God for material blessing. No. We are there to we are entitled to take the spiritual blessing of God. And we are there to understand this world. The groaning is the birth pain of a woman. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters in Christ, groaning is an experience facing the death. Groaning is experiencing a decay, a very painful experience world is undergoing and human society is undergoing. Therefore, world is subject to this kind of frustration. Today, world is under this kind of frustration. And it's also a bondage. It further leads to decay and it cannot fulfill its intended purpose. Purpose of God is not intended in this, the decay, the situation of decay. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters in Christ, God brings this great revelation to humankind that creation groans. Your spiritual world also is affected. Your material world is already cursed. And therefore, we need to understand now how God is going to liberate this groaning situation. How God is going to take care of this kind of situation. And we need not feel pessimistic about this. Because God is mightier than the evil forces. And we have hope in the future also. Because it is God created. And God will take care of this condition according to his purpose. He is not there to leave things undone or unfinished. Because he has already promised that there is no destruction of the creation in Noah's covenant. And the recreation begins. The blessing of the nation, the human beings begins from the book of Genesis chapter 11. The story of Abraham continues the promise of God. And therefore, we need to spiritually and physically fight for the new order. Isaiah talks about that. Many prophets talk about that. And even the book of Genesis talks about the new creation. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters in Christ, salvation means God's new creation. Salvation means God's new spiritual world relating to God. And salvation means the whole creation will be liberated. Therefore, the first of all, we need to understand creation in an ever-renewing formation. It always renews. Our life should be renewed. We come to the Lord today to understand what is this creation. And we are protected already. And we have lost that status of protection. If at all we are part of evil. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters in Christ, those who are hearing this message, I think we are all entitled to be renewed in our life. Renewed in new creation. Renewed in new spirit. Renewed in new formation. Secondly, creation also is affirmation of the future. We are dim today. We don't have hope for the future. And creation, the groaning of creation also conveys the message that there is no future for this world. But God is a God who renews and He brings new time for us and new order for us. Therefore, the things will end up and then we will go to the new phase of life. The creation. And thirdly, creation, Christ is not just to this world. He is a cosmic God. Christ is going to redeem everybody, redeem the whole creation. That's why Paul in chapter 8 of Romans, it talks specially about Jesus. And this groaning, this crucifixion of the creation is ended and then the new world is going to come. The new order is going to come. The new salvation methods will come. And therefore, we need to understand from this kind of groaning situation, the whole world has groaning now. And everybody is groaning now. There is no future. There is nothing called new future for this world. People are frustrated. Dear brothers and sisters, God is calling from this kind of chaos. And the creation story comes from chaos. And therefore, God brings new life from chaos, disorder. And third and fourthly, oneness in God. And we need to be part of this great God who created the world. Like He created the material world, the physical world. And human beings in His own image. We related to these two major forces of God. The spiritual world and also the material world. The created world. Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters in Christ, let me bring to your kind notice the images today we are under. The first one is the mask we wear, the COVID suits we wear, and the world which is isolated, closed down. So it is very difficult for us to have our own good breath, you know. There is no good air. There is no good environment we have created. The world is now in a decay condition. And everywhere we are protected by our own materials like gloves, sanitizers and also masks. So world is not breathing properly. And the second image is spiritual world. We thought America is one of the countries which will bring social justice, human rights, no racism. The war of racism was over, we thought. But today, this major world crisis is social anarchy, social disorder, political disorder, loss of human rights. And George Floyd is crying for taking air from his own condition. He says, I can't breathe. Human beings around the world are not breathing properly. And individually also, spiritually also, we thought the countries which are supposed to be civilized countries, they are not allowing people to breathe properly. So therefore, my dear brothers and sisters in Christ, God is going to renew this situation. God is going to renew His material creation or the life forms. He will bring new life to that. And also socially and also spiritually, we will be renewed in our churches. We are going to be renewed in our societies according to God's plan. plan and purpose. And this great God, he took groaning on him and he was crucified on the cross. And this great God also, in a groaning condition, he offered us forgiveness. He offered us the paradise. He has offered us the salvation. May God bless these words of salvation. Let us pray. God, our Heavenly Father, we thank and praise thee for the wonderful way you have led us to this day. Lord, we thank you and praise you for the way you protected us throughout this season. And at this hour of prayer, Lord, we remember your activities, your great purpose and your destiny in saving and also bringing salvation to humankind as well as to the creation. This hour of prayer, Lord, we commit ourselves, especially those who are fighting, the people who are under frustration, under severe health problems. And this hour of prayer, Lord, we submit us also into a mighty hand. Help us to understand the wars which are going between the warriors of COVID and the people, those who are struggling for life, those who are struggling to breathe. At this hour of prayer, Lord, we commit those antisocial elements and also the conditions which are decaying the society and bringing destruction, bringing division. Lord, you are the Almighty God who will engage your spiritual agents, the angels, to serve human beings. At this hour of prayer, Lord, we invoke your activity in our midst. You bring us protection from all direction. Once again, Lord, we commit all of us into your protection. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let us say Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive our trespasses as we forgive those trespasses against. Lead us not into temptation. Deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom, power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. A closing hymn is, O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder.
O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the worlds thy hand have made, I see the star, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power through display. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When through the wood, when through the wood and forest gladness wander, and hear the sing sweetly in the tree. When I look down from lofty mountain grandeur and hear the brook and feel the gentle breeze, then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God His Son not sparing sent Him to die, I scarce can take it in that on the cross my burden gladly bearing He bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Jesus with shouts of acclamation and take me home, joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim my God. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to thee. How great thou art.
May the God of peace himself sanctify you entirely, and may your spirit and soul and body be kept sound and blameless at the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Hallelujah.